Hello, everybody. Welcome to this webinar about the Global Kids Online Study. So I'm going to hand over now to Kerry Albright from UNICEF and Innocenti, and she's going to introduce this session.
Thank you very much, Sarah, and thanks everyone for signing up and for joining us today. I wanted to say a little bit of background really to kick us off, to talk about why we decided to commission this particular impact case study. So as background for the research itself, I think most people listening will probably know that ICTs now are rapidly penetrating all parts of the world, and children's experiences are being rapidly informed by the use of these technologies. So the Global Kids Online Programme, which is a collaborative programme between UNICEF, the London School of Economics, and EU Kids Online, began in 2016 to develop a more rigorous evidence base, really, related to child rights online. And I'm going to let Sonia explain a little bit more about the programme and the background to it in a minute. So from our side, we know that assessing the impact of social science research is particularly challenging and difficult. There are methodological challenges, including the time frame, trying to identify cause and effect, the fact that actually a lot of the impacts are often very unpredictable. But we felt that we were seeing enough interesting stories emerging from the research even so far that we wanted to try and capture some of those through an independent validation of some of those stories in what we're seeing as a sort of emerging pathways to impact. And because independence was so important, it wasn't just us self-reporting these stories. The piece of research, the impact case study, was commissioned out of my unit at UNICEF rather than out of LSE or UNICEF core teams who are managing the research. And we were delighted last year that when we advertised the consultancy, Sarah Morton applied for it and the matter of focus won the consultancy. I'm sure many of you know Sarah. She's a sort of international expert on research impact, particularly with an interesting sort of methodology that she's developed around using contribution analysis to track emerging outcomes. So we asked her to focus really on trying to assess impacts in three main areas. The first was the sort of the national and the global influence of the core Innocenti LSE or UNICEF LSE Secretariat or Project Steering Team, who conduct a lot of cross-country comparative research, who undertake advocacy activities, and also a lot of capacity strengthening and convening activities. The second was around the national and global influence of the research conducted by the countries themselves, across all countries in the GKO network, but in particular doing a deep dive in three of those, in Bulgaria, Uruguay, and Ghana. And then the third area that we really asked her to look at was the wider value of the network model, which we think is a really important added value about this particular way of working. So not just on knowledge exchange, but also to try and give us a bit of an insight into any spillover effects that we were seeing that were happening. So before I hand over to Sarah to present her findings, as promised, I'm going to hand you back to Professor Sonia Livingston from LSE, who's going to tell you a little bit more in-depth background about the Global Kids Online program itself.
I'm Sonia Livingstone, and I lead the team at the London School of Economics, and I'm hoping you can see my slides. Just to give you a kind of a flavour of the research before we go in depth into the impact of that research. So Global Kids Online has been conceived very ambitiously, as is implied by the idea of a global project, and it really tries to take forward the question of how we can think of children's rights in the digital age by gathering the evidence that we need to understand children's access and experiences of the internet. So Global Kids Online is working in a number of countries in the world, and in the map that I'm showing here, the darker coloured countries are the ones where we've already had data and we're beginning to compare. And this map is always out of date because more countries are coming on stream year on year as we try to encompass different parts of the world, different cultures and different kinds of experiences that children have in a digital world. So ideally, research would be done qualitatively and quantitatively, and we do have a qualitative dimension to some of the research. But the real power of a comparative study is when we have directly comparable measures in all the different surveys that are being done around the world. So the emphasis is on quantitative data and on trying to find the measures and indicators that really allow us to compare countries so that we can see the ways in which they have similar, or children have similar experiences of the internet in those countries, and the dimensions on which they begin to differ. It's very important to Global Kids Online that we ask two research questions simultaneously, one focusing on the opportunities that the internet can bring for children's lives and one focusing on the risk of harm. So our two research questions are phrased here to kind of keep that sense of balance. First, we ask how, when and how does use of the internet contribute positively to children's lives? And we're interested in the diverse experiences and diverse opportunities to benefit that may contribute to their well-being. And then we also ask, a kind of in balance with that, when and how is use of the internet problematic in children's lives, and when does it amplify the risk of harm and potentially undermine their well-being? So we've spent a while within the network identifying the different measures that would reveal what are positive dimensions of the internet and those which would indicate what are the potential negatives. So here's our kind of grand model. I'm not going to explain it in depth in this short presentation, but we have a number of documents on the website where we really try to kind of set out our framework. But I think what you can see here is that we're asking questions about the relation between children's identity and their well at the start, if you like, and their well-being outcomes at the end. Thinking in terms of that purple section in the middle, what difference does it make that they're engaging with online practices, developing online skills, and encountering opportunities and risks? And we're trying to think about the different measures of all of those features at the individual level, the level of the child, also at the social level, thinking about the role of family, educators, peers, community, and the kind of specific digital ecology that children are growing up in. And then we also recognize the importance of country level factors, and we've just put some here in the model, but there are many ways in which countries vary. So I really wanted to give you a sense that within that kind of broad research questions about opportunities and risks, we're trying to find lots of different measures about how the internet might make a difference to children's well-being. And we're asking those questions in lots of different countries. So it's really a very kind of sizable research enterprise. And the big question, of course, is whether the findings have any impact. So I'll just end with the website and invite everyone to visit the website to see that we have both all of our research tools there and our results there, and indeed this webinar and the results of Sarah's research will also find their way onto the website at globalkidsonline.net in due course. But now I'm going to pass to Sarah Morton, who will tell us whether our kind of big effort in data collection has had any impact.
Thanks, Sonia, and thank you for that introduction. That's really helpful. So to start off with, I'm from Matter of Focus. We're a mission-led company, and as Kerry said in the introduction, we work with organisations helping them to understand and track whether or not they make a difference. And our approach is particularly useful for understanding the kind of contribution of complex programmes like this to outcomes and trying to really tell the story of how these kind of complex programmes make a difference. And what I'm going to do in this presentation is talk through the background to the study, the methods that we use to understand the impact of Global Kids Online, a little bit around the Global Kids Online approach, and then I'm going to take you through some headline findings with a couple of impact stories from the case studies, and then also wrap up with some lessons learned and recommendations. And I just wanted to first of all say it wasn't just me working on this, it was actually a team of five of us. And also Alessandra Ipins, who is from UNICEF, was also involved in the field work. And so this is, it was actually quite a big scope for a short amount of time, as you'll see in a moment. And I want to start off by saying a little bit about how we think about research impacts in this context, because we're looking at people inspiring and encouraging other countries to do their own research right across the globe. So it's quite a complicated picture. And so I think it's a little bit like research impacts, a little bit like sort of throwing the pebble into the pond and kind of seeing where the ripples go. And so we're trying to really understand and capture some of these ripples and understand their intensity. And I use this framework which divides research impact into three kind of key areas. So, you know, a lot of researchers spend a lot of time on what we would call research uptake, which is getting people interested in research, maybe having websites or social media or all the kind of ways, responding to policy consultations, all the many, many ways that research interacts with people in order to get them interested in it. But it's actually what happens after that that's important in terms of impact. So people need to actually use research in some way. They need to change their mind. They need to pass it to other people. They need to apply it in some way to a policy or practice setting in order for it to make a difference. And importantly, we talk about a contribution to change, because in the world of social research, it's not like we're curing cancer. It's a process of influencing rather than direct cause and effect. And this looks very neat and linear, but I like to think of it more like this, because of course it doesn't all happen at the same time and it happens for different people at different times. And we know from research in this area that there's some key things that really help with research impact. And you can see quite a lot of these playing out in the Global Kids Online study. So having established relationships and networks, and we know the network effect is important here. I'm going to say quite a lot throughout the presentation about when research users were or weren't involved with research, having kind of knowledge engagement, user engagement and knowledge translation and engagement strategies. And also what you see here is it's not just about one research, but it's actually about a portfolio of research activity around this area of Global Kids Online that Sonia and colleagues have led at LSE and that people at UNICEF have been involved in more recently, that kind of builds this reputation and gives some of the impacts. So the methodology we used took this understanding of research impact that I mentioned earlier on, and basically what it is it creates a theory of change that sets out a pathway to impact, and then it tests that against the evidence. So it reviews the theory of change, it reviews the gaps in evidence, and it collects more data. And the basic format that we use for that is this one. It looks very, very simple, but I like to think it's actually, it's very, very well thought through, and we spent a lot of time refining it to be this beautifully simple. So we think about what we do, who with, and we have these two steps in our way of setting out a pathway to impact that includes a level of reaction, so how people feel, because when we're talking about influencing work, it's really people's ability to engage, to feel positive about what they're being asked to do or what they're being asked to engage with, and being open to learning, and that there being some capacity building before people actually do things differently, and that makes a difference to somebody. So if you look at it like this, we think about mapping out the key research and knowledge exchange activities, who's been engaged and involved, how they reacted, what was it that helped them engage positively? What knowledge, skills, attitudes, or capacities did they gain? What behaviors, practices, or policies change? And what difference did that make? So what in the end was better for people or communities? And if we're thinking about those things I said earlier, research uptake is around engagement, research use is around what people do, and then we see research impact at the top of this pathway. So in order to work with this particular project, this is what we did. We started off with an outcome mapping workshop with the GKO management team, which we're not calling the secretariat anymore, sorry about that. And so that was basically the leaders of this project from UNICEF and from LSE. And we spent a day thinking about, well, what do these pathways look like in this particular project? And I'm going to tell you a bit more about how we framed that. And then we did interviews by phone and Skype with 29 stakeholders internationally. We did field trips to Uruguay, Ghana, and Bulgaria, and we've done some documentary analysis of some of the relevant documents to this, and also some of the project data. And so we set out three pathways in this case. The first one is what the Global Kids Online team do in sort of inspiring other countries to do research and supporting that process. And then we did one which was looking very much at the partner countries' actions and how they conducted their research, who with, and how that led to impact. And then finally, we looked at the tricky and difficult area of influencing global debate and action. So I'm going to go through each of those in turn now, and then we'll stop for some questions. So this is the first pathway, which is how the Global Kids Online Management Team inspire and support research to happen in the partner countries and also more widely with other researchers. So you can see on the left there, it's about leading the development of the framework, supporting high quality research, creating the network, and publishing and publicizing the activities. And so we were looking at how do partner countries feel in terms of being supported to do research? How are they using the tools? How are they connecting with other countries? What are they actually managing to achieve the kind of level of research that was envisaged by the program? And then what difference does that make? And what we found when we did all of the interviews in this, all of the data collection in this, that Global Kids Online Research is really regarded as the premier resource on children's experiences online, both in partner countries and by international stakeholders and influencers. It's held in very high regard. It's really, really widely trusted as high quality and important. And we found that in terms of inspiring and supporting research, the partner countries talked a lot about how important it was to have that central support to help them, particularly adapting research to be contextually relevant, but also high quality. And also that they really benefited from being part of a network, especially being able to compare results with other countries that were closer to them. In a lot of areas of the world, people were looking to their neighbours and saying, oh, well, it's interesting what they've done, we should maybe do it. But also then looking at their neighbours' results and saying, oh, what's similar and different between us and them? And sometimes joining with the neighbours and doing creating action together. So in terms of support, there's quite a relationship building focus. I mean, my background is in research in knowledge exchange. And what you find is that the people part of knowledge mobilization is so, so important. And that's what we found here. So people commented on actually, it was the people who helped them do it that was most important, whether that was a lot of people commented about Daniel, because I know he does a lot of this support from UNICEF and Innocenti, but also the other people that they'd had in their networks who'd helped them actually complete research. And then secondly, the adaptation. You know, it's been really important that people feel they can make this research relevant to their country context. And sometimes that's really complex. I'm going to talk about Ghana in a moment, which has many languages, but the international stakeholders also commented on the fact that it's not a European research project that is actually properly adapted to make sense in these highly, highly contrasting places. And then the network effects, people feeling that they're learning what's been done in other countries, what happens in the region, and learning from their neighbours and what's similar about their findings and their experiences of children online. So basically, for this part of the pathway to impact, Global Kids Online is a highly effective program in terms of getting countries to plan and do research. And you can see from Sonia's map earlier, you know, it's constantly evolving. Even during the time we've been doing the research, we've had to update a few things because countries have come on board or countries have got to a different stage. The things that were raised more in this area were, is there a strategy for engaging with specific countries? Because I think what they've done is really thrown the net open and invited people to join in, which has been really a positive thing. But some people were saying, well, maybe strategically it'd be good to get certain people on board and there could be a strategy. Some people would like a bit more clarity about what happens when you join and what does it mean to actually be a member? And while they really appreciated the advice in terms of delivering research, there several people commented on the fact that the model tended to be, even though there's some really good impact advice, the model tended to be do the research and then disseminate, whereas actually the whole kind of partnership and impact planning from the start could be more integrated. So I'm going to move on now and look specifically at some of the partner country impacts. So for this area of work, we set out this broad pathway to impact, which basically has research activities being planning and conducting for research and sharing it widely, and then engagement being research partners and media. And so research partners would include policy practice, industry, children's organisations, NGOs, whatever is relevant in any context. And then people need to be feeling that this, that research is useful, which of course is quite a big statement in itself, and in some places we see that much more strongly than others. And also they need to feel inspired to take action. And then we're looking at the kind of research use being around actually using this high quality resource and building capacity, and then some contributions to policy and practice that mean that children eventually are going to be safer online and adults are going to respond more appropriately. So this was our pathway to impact in this area. And what we found across the different countries is there's really some really strong local partnerships that help to achieve impact. And actually everyone is engaging in some way, either during the process of setting up the research, or certainly all of them are engaging with key partners in terms of dissemination. We found quite extensive use of the research to influence policy and practice in 9 partner countries, and that includes education, telecommunications, policy and interventions, which I'll say a little bit more about, and then really wide evidence of engagement and changes in knowledge, skills and attitudes across many countries, not just from the findings of the research, but particularly from some of the conceptual contributions, and particularly people talk a lot about balancing protection and participation, and that even if they came because they were interested in protecting children, actually during the time they were involved, they started thinking more broadly. I'm going to give you some examples of these contributions in the next few slides. So the first one is some contributions to regulation. So in South Africa, Global Kids Online has influenced the regulator to reduce data costs because they found that was the biggest barrier for children getting online. In terms of policy and practice in Bulgaria, children's online safety standards have been included in the draft strategy for child protection for the first time, and there's a direct link between the research and that. And in the Philippines, this photo is of a press launch of a new curriculum which is going to include digital skills within modules for younger children. In Montenegro, the UNICEF country office has developed a game, or it's an app, which 9 to 11 year olds can use to play and talk about safer choices online. And so that's something that's directly aimed at children. There's a few other examples of things directly aimed at children. So that's just some kind of little highlights, but I suppose what we found from looking at these partner countries and their impacts is that the exact configuration of partners as individuals and organisations and the specific context influence the extent and nature of impact. So in some places, UNICEF are leading the research, in some places it's another agency, and in some places it's an academic lead. And actually it's interesting because it isn't just the agency, although of course some of the agencies are incredibly well connected in this field, so they've got a sort of automatic audience for impact in a way that others don't. But also sometimes the individuals, so in one place, for example, there was a comms manager leading it. So she was very kind of wired into actually talking and communicating on social media and elsewhere about the research as it was unfolding. We found that where academics were the lead, they were the least likely to engage with non-academic partners from the start of the research. And they tended to see engagement as relevant for dissemination only much more. And where partnership was at the core of the research process, there were definitely clearer links to impact, even though sometimes, as you'll see in a minute, the partnership process wasn't necessarily as simple as it might have been. So I'm just going to go through the 3 case studies that we did now. So this was Bulgaria, Ghana and Uruguay in alphabetical order. So no, that's why the order is as it is. So in Bulgaria, what they did was they led the research project. It was led by the Bulgarian Safer Internet Center. And actually, this was one of the examples where it was already an agency active in this area that had really good links. So there was a very kind of high level of engagement with industry, with government, with NGOs and with the university, but mainly it was mainly dissemination, although they did a lot of work around dissemination, getting the right people around the table. In terms of the research, they interviewed 1,000 children and 130 families. There's quite an emphasis on qualitative, And they were really interested in balancing activities, risks and skills development. So it wasn't, they didn't go with a protection agenda or a participation agenda. They definitely had this balance. And for them, the key insights in terms of what they found were that children talk to other children rather than talking to adults if they have a problem online or any issues online. They were really interested in the fact that fathers were particularly not involved with their children in terms of their online activities. And they were also quite surprised about the extent of access. So even the poorest households had access to the internet, and they found that people would prioritize access to the internet over other basics. And so what did they do as a result of that? Well, there's three areas where you can see they made a contribution. There's quite a big emphasis on directly working with children in Bulgaria. So there's a Cyber Scouts program, which has trained 2,000 young people so far in internet safety. They've included digital literacy in the school curriculum, and they have a Media Literacy Month campaign every year that's aimed at children and families. In policy terms, digital literacy is included in education policy, and online safety is included in the draft child protection strategy. And in practice, this is a really interesting one, actually, because they've actually got an audit in schools on the digital literacy teaching. So we've got quite a lot of people beginning to introduce digital literacy teaching, but interestingly, in Bulgaria, they're auditing it as well, so they can really see how that is working. And this is just a little screenshot of their Cyber Scout training program resources that are online and some of the things that it covers. And so then if we look at Ghana, their research was led by UNICEF. And it was interesting because they took a very sort of formal approach to partnership, and they had organizations very much engaged in doing the research together, and policymakers and practitioners, NGOs talking about how the research should be carried out. And for them, the research, really the emphasis was, for them, the big part of work was translation and adaptation, because they've got such cultural diversity. I think they have 50 languages, so making sure the research was going to work in all of these different places. And they very much had an emphasis on child protection. They came into Global Kids Online because they were interested in child protection. Now, there's some quite a lot of commonality in what the key insights that they felt were important for action. So the peer support one's the same, that actually when children have a problem, they're not very likely to go to adults, they're much more likely to go to other children. They particularly noted the kind of prevalence of sexualized activities and abuse online in their country. And also in terms of access, they found that many children had, many more children than they thought had access, because people share devices. So when they looked at how many devices were out there, they hadn't actually seen that it was through sharing that a lot of children were getting online. And in terms of what they've done with those findings, in terms of things aimed at children, they've developed an app which allows children and young people to report online abuse more easily. So they're trying to make a clearer link into the criminal end of what's happening to children. And they've got a Safer Schools program, which is rolled out across a lot of schools, and it now includes cyberbullying, which it didn't before. Internet safety has been prioritised by the National Security Centre, and there's been some lobbying for child online protection to be included in the new Children's Act, which is going through Parliament. And interestingly, for them, they've done a lot of training. So 895 schools and 166 communities have been included in training, and the teachers are including these cyberbullying lessons in Safer Schools. And then if I turn to Uruguay, last but not least, they were also, research here was also led by UNICEF and partners. Again, they had a formal partnership, and actually what was really fascinating about the Uruguay story is the partnership wasn't necessarily very smooth, but they spent a long time actually agreeing the finding statement that they could all sign up to. And then each partner had its own finding statement that was specific to the issues that mattered most to them. And Uruguay context is really interesting because they already had a participation ethic. So there'd already been a predating policy that had tried to get every single child online. So what the Global Kids Online helped them look at was what were the safety implications of having that sort of policy. And the key insights in Uruguay were the high percentage of adverse experiences, but few reported to adults. So again, similar. The fact that parents had such low levels of knowledge and skills and felt very unskilled. And also for them, one of the important ones was that children didn't like some of the effects they thought digital media was having on their parents. So that's quite different from the other countries. In terms of what they've been doing, there's been a lot of emphasis on work with children and families. So there's a countrywide program of interventions and support, which has been co-designed with parents and children and young people. And that has been a really massive effort. I can't really do it justice in one sentence, I'm afraid, but there's more details in the report. And then the Human Rights Ombudsman have taken over, have considered the findings for the media education plan. And in policy, they also, some decision makers allowed young people who'd been involved in the co-production, the co-design program, to take over their Twitter accounts for a day, which I think is a really interesting and innovative way of increasing impact. And then in terms of practice, teachers and wider professionals have then been engaged with this campaign that's been led by the young people. So it's been really a participatory ethic in terms of how they've worked on impact in Uruguay. So in terms of just thinking about what we've learned from the case studies, again, we got a little bit more in depth than we got from just looking at the other partner countries. And we can see this kind of different emphasis on protection and participation that plays out in different places, and perhaps an emerging journey from protection to a more balanced approach in a few places. Partnership working is absolutely key to impact, but not always straightforward. And I think there would be great opportunity. Someone needs to do a PhD on global kids online partnerships, because I think there's a lot of learning we could get out of all these different models, but working on the same sort of research. And then basically we're seeing impacts based on a configuration of the organizations and individuals involved, the kind of key findings of the context, which is probably not that surprising, but I suppose that's quite a nice way of thinking about it. And I was quite struck that actually the key findings that have been highlighted for action, and I don't know, I'd have to ask Sonia a bit more about, are they the key findings that have been highlighted for everything, but the key findings for action have been quite similar in these very different places. Now, finally, before I finish, I want to quickly go over how we've looked at how the Global Kids Online program has influenced international debate and action. And for this area, we set up a pathway to impact that looked really at how the Global Kids Online program shared knowledge through networking, policy debate, acting as a critical friend, sharing discussions and findings on the sort of global stage with UN agencies, with global companies, with sort of civil society, more working at this level and governance bodies. And so we tried to investigate as much as we could the extent that the evidence was seen as really important, that the GKOs team are seen as experts, and that stakeholders are becoming more aware about what's happening with children online, and then that's contributing to changes in knowledge and skills and potentially changes to behaviour and practice. I just want to say that obviously this is a contentious and highly political, high profile kind of area of work, and we found that it was very high profile and highly trusted study, but actually it's really hard to trace impacts in this sort of arena, and particularly given we're only talking about something that's been going on since 2015, although there's some other work that predates that, it's quite difficult to do. But we do see this international picture of children's experiences being really important to different people in this arena. So we've got some specific ways that the Global Kids Online research has been used that seem to be quite important, though it's not always possible to trace exactly how. So there's a 1 in 3 paper published by UNICEF, which is a discussion paper, which has been really widely cited and a lot of people talked about. There's a State of the World's Children report in 2017, which is a UNICEF paper, which calls on for government action on harms and opportunities for children online. And the Council of Europe in 2018 created guidelines calling on member states to respect, protect and fulfill the rights of children in digital environment. And we can see a clear link with Global Kids Online being a significant contribution to all of these. The Global Partnership to End Violence Against Children is an international organization, and they cite Global Kids Online, and they've got plans to include digital harm in the way that they work across the globe. The International Telecommunications Union Expert Group on ICT Household Indicators used the toolkit, and we can see some clear evidence of that. And we can also see the report being shared on the cybersecurity portal, which is to help countries across the world build capacity around cybersecurity. The International Telecommunication Union recommends the toolkit to its expert group members. So they say that there's references that should be considered as a methodological framework. So they're it's stronger than just it's there. They're actually making a kind of clear recommendation. And we got gathered quite a lot of kind of thoughts and reflections on the kind of contribution that Global Kids Online was making. And so the sorts of thing people said was that it presents a really important horizon for the field internationally. The fact that it's even there means a lot of things would not otherwise happen are able to happen. The fact there is a global resource is really important. And also a lot of people reflected on the fact that actually, if you only had research on European children, then it was very easy for other parts of the world to dismiss that research. And now you can see that actually there's quite similar experiences for children in different parts of the world. So it's much, much harder for big global multinationals to ignore or pick and choose what they hear or what they wanted to hear. That point was reflected by quite a lot of people that we interviewed. Someone else was saying that the word of Global Kids Online is making an impact because it's not just about what you do on your own, but it's the kind of this committed network of scholars and practitioners internationally who all have similar views and are using the same evidence base, and that's quite a powerful way of creating impact. So I just want to make a few summing up points before I finish. First of all, I put up this slide of the ripples, because I think when we look at Global Kids Online, rather than throwing one stone into a lake, it's like throwing many, many stones into a lake. And what I like about this slide is you can see the ways that the ripples interact in some places in more intense ways than others, but also get a sense of how challenging it is to really capture all of that in one place. And we've got some recommendations based on what we found from this study. The first one is really about embedding impact advice. So there's a lot of emphasis on how to do research, and there's some great tools online. There's a really nice impact kit online. But actually, what we know is that people respond much more to conversation and discussion. And so that conversation and discussion about who are partners, where are they going to be, how are they going to be involved, needs to happen earlier. It will be great to be tracking impact regularly, and I know that the team have made some efforts in this direction, but it's quite difficult to get people to comply to tracking impact when they don't have to. But it will be really great to carry on getting feedback on some of these policy and practice impacts over time, and particularly on the contribution to international debate and action. And as I said earlier, I think there'll be a lot more to say about partnership if we could kind of track how partnership plays out. And then a few people, as I mentioned earlier, have said it would be great if there was a kind of slightly more strategic approach where people felt they knew what they were buying into. I know there's some challenges around resourcing that, but that's one of the recommendations. So I'm going to end my presentation there, and really happy to have some discussion and questions with me or any of the rest of the team.
Thank you very much, Sarah. That was great. I've seen that different people have put questions both in the Q&A and in the chat box. So I'm going to sort of jump about between those two. So in the Q&A, the first question that appeared was from Davina, saying, can we also have multimodal ethnographic research methods to study this? So Sonia, would you maybe like to comment on that?
Very happy to. I think, as I said, we would love there to be both qualitative and quantitative research methods being used throughout the work. I think we think of the qualitative methods as really giving the sense of what's distinctive and what's culturally embedded in different cultures where children go online. And it's the surveys that give more comparability. And there was a question later about comparability as well. So our ideal would be begin with a qualitative. So we do have a qualitative research toolkit, Davina. It's not fully ethnographic, but it includes qualitative interviews and focus group work to be done with children and parents. And we'd love to see more of that used. Kerry, can I just ask one of the other questions about the survey and the comparability? So the way we've designed the survey is that we have a core element, which all countries ask. We have optional questions for the countries that want to specialize in different areas and take it forward. And then we've identified ways in which questions can be adapted depending on the different countries and cultures. And that's where the ethnographic or interview qualitative research can come forward and say there are ways in which a survey needs to be tailored to make sense in the very different countries that we're studying. But there is that core comparability, and then there is that scope for adaptation and contextualization.
Thank you, Sonia. The next question from the Q&A box was from Khadija, who said, were there similarities in the experiences of the children across countries? So I want to get two people responding to that. Maybe just Sarah, from what you and your team kind of noted from the study, and then I'm going to hand over to Daniel, who's also been leading on cross-country data comparison from the surveys themselves. So Sarah, your views on that question?
Yeah, well, you'll have seen in those last few slides that I did, but I was quite surprised actually that the findings that people had really highlighted in terms of impact, which of course isn't all of the findings necessarily, but the ones that they felt were important were quite similar. So particularly the fact that children turn to other children if they want help rather than turning to adults, which interestingly for me, because I've worked in children and families research for a while, I've seen that in other completely different kinds of settings, nothing to do with online. Actually, children tend to turn to other children for help, and that, you know, that can be quite problematic for the adults in their lives for various reasons. And then the other thing was how much people were surprised about the extent to which children were accessing online content and how young they were. Those are the things that kind of came across.
And then to jump in from my end, I think in general we see more similarities than we would have expected, perhaps, across countries that are very, very different. I think there are two things that come to mind for me. And one thing is that we see almost across the board that the percentage of children who experience risk is fairly low, at least lower than what you would expect if you listen into the media discourse. And the percentage of children who report feeling harmed by various online experiences is perhaps even lower. So that's one piece of good news. We also see across the board that children do not talk to teachers about things that bother them online, which I think is quite surprising, but it's very consistent across very different countries. There are a number of similarities there that perhaps surprised us a fair bit.
So in which types of partnership was the impact greatest? Was it when it was government-led or when it was private partner-led? So Sarah, back to you for your observations on that.
Yeah, thanks. I don't think, so they were never government-led. The ones I looked at, usually it's UNICEF or another agency taking the lead, and sometimes an academic institution taking the lead. I think the thing about partnership is it has to be the right partnership for the place. And I suppose it depends on why you're doing the study in the first place. What are you hoping to have an impact on, and who's important to achieving that impact? So I suppose the whole partnership planning part of it needs to be completely contextualized. So what we found was where there were close partnerships between policy actors, researchers, NGOs, other people who have an influence on these outcomes, then because they were involved in the whole process of actually doing the research, they were helping shape some of the ways the research was being done. They were thinking through all of the implications of doing this research right from the beginning. So by the time there were findings, you've got this really warmed up arena ready to really take hold of those findings and use them to make a difference. So it's really about planning very carefully in the context for the particular partnership that's going to be right for that place.
To what extent has this been utilized in the Philippines, and how can we partner in the government?
So the study in the Philippines, actually we did one of the first pilot studies in the Philippines back in 2016. And then the UNICEF office there went ahead to do a second study, which just finished earlier this year. So the report is actually not out yet. I know that they've already had conversations with the government, but how exactly to utilize the report, I think we'll see over the next coming months as the final one is released.
Okay.
Thank you. I can add something to that.
Go, Sarah, please.
Yeah, so there is evidence in the Philippines of it being used to influence the curriculum and to be included in the curriculum. And you've also said, how can we partner the government? I'm not sure I'm the right person to answer that question. But what I suppose my reflection is that we learned that partnership was really linked to impact, but we didn't do a study of partnership. We did a study of impact, which is why I said earlier, actually it would be great to do more on partnership, because I think this is such a rich resource for learning about partnership. And should I just answer this other partnership question while I'm on the...
About the difficulties, yes, please.
Yeah, so I think what happens in terms of difficulties is that, you know, people come with very different expectations about what they want, and they also have come with different, from different sectors, with different drivers of what's important. You know, so for the academics, they want to make sure it's a very robust, comparable study that's going to help them get academic publications. The policy people want to know about whatever the policy issues that's bothering them at the moment. The NGOs maybe feel that they want to follow what children are interested in, so there can be all these different agendas. And so it just takes time to work those out. So I think what we can see is places where the study's landing in a warmed up partnership, where people have already been used to working together. Of course, all of that's much easier than if you're starting from scratch and trying to build a partnership without those networks at the beginning. But usually, because it's going through UNICEF, those networks exist. You know, that UNICEF offices have been working for years, and they have government partners and other stakeholder partners that they can pull on in terms of doing the research. So it's usually just a process of kind of valuing and spending the time to make partnership work and get all of those expectations out on the table and be clear about what is and isn't within the scope of partnership, that really helps to overcome the difficulties.
Has there been any specific focus on the use of social media by children, particularly in the 9 to 13 age group, i.e., you know, preteens?
Yes, absolutely. So it's one of those examples where we really see social media broadly as an opportunity for young people. And we have a section on communication in the questionnaire where we ask all the children, actually, from 9 through 17, a series of questions about their relationships, identities, communication online. It raises one of the difficult questions, which is often it's different social media that are used in different countries. So that's a case in which the survey gets tailored to the specific social media of that country. And assuming that maybe Mark's implication is that those 9 to 13 year olds are, as it were, underage as users, we have not paid attention to that. If children are using social media when they're 9, 10, 11, 12, they will tell us that in the survey. And I think it's really important then that we have those findings to take to the government or the regulator or indeed the industry and say children are using social media underage. I mean, just one last thing to add there, perhaps. We also might think of social media as a kind of a risky opportunity, and there's a lot of anxieties about younger children, especially using social media. So we do also have ways in which the data allow us to track through from social media use through to children's experience of online risk. And that's something that we really look for in the analysis.
Could you perhaps share some anecdotes on researchers and or UNICEF's experience and instances where the government in their country office for the research exercise was resistant to the initiative? And what were the reasons? Daniel, do you want to react to that?
Yeah, I mean, the spontaneous reaction is that it's hard for us to say much about that. And that question would really be best directed to the country officers who worked on the project. But in general, my understanding is that we haven't had these kinds of problems on the project, and governments that we've worked with have been overall very positive to this initiative. But again, it's a question that country office colleagues are better positioned to respond to.
Can I add a little to that?
Please, go ahead.
Yeah, so I agree we haven't had out and out resistance, I think there's an interesting kind of story to be told about the timing of which countries come forward at which time to say, we'd now like to join, we'd now like to do the research. And it's something about, as it were, when the timing is right in that country. And that depends on how much the internet has spread in a particular country, and perhaps how much the opportunities and especially the problems that it gives rise to have kind of landed on the desks of the policymakers and the politicians. So it's not so much that, you know, we're saying you need to do this survey now in any country. We're waiting until they really see the need, and then they can join the project. And at that point, as it were, the political will is with the project.
What surprised you most? Was there anything, I mean, there's, you know, what I see from this, there's quite a lot of innovations, quite some, you know, exciting stuff happening around the different countries. But was there anything either in terms of an innovation or in terms of an insight or something that you hadn't heard before, something that was surprising?
I mean, I think there was, what was really interesting is, and I think what's brilliant about this study actually is you get people doing the sort of same thing, but actually they do it in so, so many different ways. So there's some really exciting, interesting ways of engaging children. There, I think probably one of my favorite sort of anecdotes is this one teacher in Bulgaria who working in this very, very sort of strict, regimented kind of school, hierarchical school setting, who had completely redesigned her classroom to be focused around children and their own experiences and with a lot of internet use and then following their own questions. But it's kind of such a radical, like that, even here that would be radical, but in this particular setting, in this school where things were taught in very, very traditional hierarchical ways, it was particularly striking. But no, I think generally just, I think it would be great, that's why I was saying it'd be great to kind of try and keep capturing this, because I'm sure lots of people would learn from each other. And if you look at, you know, there's different emphases on children's participation or on policy work or on internet regulators, you know, we could all be learning from.
In terms of whether the general GKO questions, the survey questions are available, I'll hand over to Sonia to answer that. And then maybe, Sonia, if you want to answer it as if it were asking about the sorts of questions that you and the team asked for the impact case study. So, Sonia?
Yeah, absolutely. So all the research materials for Global Kids Online are available on the internet at globalkidsonline.net/tools. And if you look in the tools section, you'll see qualitative, quantitative, a series of method guides which kind of address a lot of the issues around doing the research, like how to do research with younger children, or what are the ethical issues involved in doing the research, or how do we ensure comparability across countries. And then we have a newer section on impact and the impact tools that we really hope researchers will embed really from the start of planning their research. So yes, all the questions to children are freely available online, and please take a look at them and use them. And the questions that we asked to Sarah to explore in the in her impact study, I think will be embedded in some way in the final report that Sarah and her team have written and that we will be putting online at globalkidsonline.net.
Great, thank you. Okay, there are some more questions coming in now. So another question from Victoria. Have you found a growing consensus on what exactly constitutes child wellbeing and how to measure it? So again, maybe Sonia start, and then Daniel, if you have something you'd like to add.
So I'm going to be honest here. I think it's a fabulous concept, child wellbeing, and it's extraordinarily difficult to measure. And it's very difficult to measure, especially in the many countries that we're working in where there are different kind of priorities and concerns about child well-being. So in one sense, we've tried a number of measures in the survey, especially from very simple, just, you know, how are you, as it were, how do you think of your life, from a scale from kind of terrible to fabulous. And that works quite well. It doesn't capture all the nuance. And then we have some more nuanced questions as well. And in our kind of statistical analysis, we can look at the patterns between those. Digital well-being is a bit of a different thing, and I think that's something that the wider research and policy community is still debating. But for me, the growing consensus, and I think is really important, that emerges from Sarah's report, is that the consensus is that we have to look at well-being holistically. So we a lot of the research begins with a worry about children at risk and the kind of harms that might come to them from engaging with the internet. And that, you know, can become the main well-being story. And I think the growing consensus that we see is people now really understand that we need to think about well-being, both in terms of risks and in terms of opportunities that children encounter, and see the whole thing together.
What next? What's next for GKO? From the insights from this, from Sarah and team's study, the next steps, etc. Maria has typed a few initial thoughts. Maria, for those that don't know her, Maria Stoliver is also at LSE and part of the core management team for the project. Daniel has to go in a minute. Do you want to have a quick reaction? And then I'm going to hand back to Sonia to also say what's next from her point of view.
I just want to pick up on what Sarah talked about, partnerships and how we can engage better with different partners from the beginning. So we are rolling out a number of new Global Kids Online surveys this year, partly as part of our new Disrupting Harm project. And there we're placing a lot of emphasis on connecting with the right partners right from the beginning of the project and making sure that they're involved, that they're making decisions, and that they can influence the outcomes throughout the whole project. So that's one strong learning that we're taking with us.
Thank you. And Sonia, anything to add?
There are so many things we want to do next. I think the Sarah's impact report has really given us a lot to think about in terms of how we coordinate the project. We began with four countries in what could be a fairly kind of well-sustained conversation. And now, as the number of countries grows, we need to think in a more structured way about how we kind of sustain the coordination and the communication. So there's some great suggestions in terms of outreach, in terms of kind of network communication, in terms of advanced planning of events and so forth that we, I think we can really take on board. I mean, as a researcher, I'm also, one thing Daniel and I and Maria are just doing is playing with the extraordinary amount of data that is now being collected and kind of co-owned across all the partners, because we can really now begin to ask some of the questions in that model that I showed at the start, which is, as it were, not just how many children experience this or how many children are online, but what is the relationship between, let's say, the kind of access children have to the internet and how many digital skills they develop? Or what is the relationship between how they're developing their digital skills and then whether they really, whether that really improves their well-being? And one question that a lot of people ask us is about parents. You know, what can parents do? And if parents play particular kinds of roles in their children's internet use, what effect does that have on the children's experience of risk or opportunities? So, you know, there's lots of questions we can ask within the model that we can now begin testing in that data set and really look and see how we get a better understanding overall of the of what makes a difference to the children's impact, because that will drive forward our next set of questions about impact, really. If parents are important, that's the messaging we would have for countries about how to support parenting. But if schooling is more important, you know, we take the kind of impact plans in a direction towards education. So the research and the impact is a kind of dialogue between the two.
With all the Global Kids Online research, what do you think should be the effect for teaching and learning?
Yeah, I think, I appreciate that schools around the world are facing lots of very different challenges and very different priorities. But, you know, to go back to that question of timing, we're doing the research at the moment in each country at which the internet has really come on the policy agenda. And I think as it comes on the policy agenda and on the kind of public agenda, that is the moment for it really to be embedded in teaching and learning as well. So it's very heartening to read in Sarah's report also a number of the ways in which the findings are being used to kind of trigger curriculum rethinking, or, you know, more embedding of digital literacy and education in schools, because schools have just such a crucial role to play, and they reach most of the children in most countries. So they're, you know, they're the brilliant way of improving skills and improving digital well-being.
Will you have to revise quickly so they're still relevant to countries interested in participating?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I have two kinds of answers to that. One is we've tried very hard to phrase the questions in a way that isn't like tied to particular social media platforms or tied to particular internet practices that are aging. So in a sense, we really want the data to stay relevant, because it's so important that we can compare what was found in 2005 with what's found in 2019 or in 2024. You know, so we want that sustained relevance. But I will tell you that behind the scenes this summer, the management team is engaging in a kind of review of all the questions that we've asked. And we're looking to see which ones have been most telling, which ones have really kind of proved their worth in terms of that flow from question through findings to impact. And we're trying to redefine the core of the survey around what's really proving valuable. And then we're also looking to see what all the different countries participating wanted to add, what for them is new, and what are the new challenges. So Internet of Things is one new kind of challenge, or the rise of hate online in many cultures is a new challenge. So we're also adding new questions, mainly as optional, so that when, if countries consider them really relevant to them, they can include them.
Have you noticed any correlations between children's everyday play, particularly with mobile devices, and digital literacies?
Yes, absolutely. One of our kind of really core findings is that the more children engage with digital technologies, possibly up to a limit, but broadly, the more they engage and the more, whether it's playful or educational, but, you know, the more they play, more they engage, the more digital skills they develop. And the more digital skills they develop, we also see a positive association with the kind of range of activities they engage in. So we've thought about that as a kind of ladder of participation from, because what we see very often is that children at the start, when they don't engage very deeply with the internet, tend to kind of mainly receive mass media content, but they don't necessarily create their own content or engage civically or kind of do some more ambitious, develop some more advanced skills that one might hope. But as they do more, they kind of do more deeper and more complex forms of participation. So yeah, access is all. And if Daniel were here, he'd be very glad to hear me say that playing games is one way that children gain confidence and find the internet fun, and that then stimulates their further learning.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much for that. I wanted to give the opportunity for first Sarah and then for Sonia to have a couple of final words as well. So Sarah, any passing words of wisdom on how we can better embed impact in our research, or anything else you'd like to share for that matter?
Thank you. Thanks everyone for coming. It's been really nice to have this chance to share the findings with everyone. And as Kerry said, there'll be a report out so you can read it, as well as the recording of the webinar. I think it's been really fascinating for me doing an impact study on this sort of scale, because I've done a lot of impact studies in different places on different kinds of research projects. And I think one on this scale in some ways has been quite challenging, but also really fascinating. And one of the things Amy and I were doing yesterday is we're also writing a ref impact case study for Sonia's team as part of this commission. And we were just adding up the number of children who are potentially affected, where we actually know there is impact, looking at the right age groups and everything. And it was something like 70 million. So it's just immense, the sort of scope. And so I think it's been really fascinating. And also, I suppose the other, for me, one of the main kind of learning is actually research impact's not that different anywhere. Like, it's still based on the things that I knew about research impact from where when I've looked in other places. So that's been really interesting to find out.
Thanks very much, Sarah. And your insights have been really useful and valuable to the team. Sonia, final words of wisdom?
Yeah, maybe for researchers out there, one thing that struck me in Sarah's report is when she said that some of the academics leading in different teams were kind of struggling more with some of the thinking around impact than when it's led by a UNICEF country office or an NGO. And I think that's right. I think for researchers, there's been quite a kind of learning process of seeing that we ask the research questions and we think about the possible impact of the answers, and those things have got to go hand in hand. And so, you know, for me, the whole Global Kids Online project has been a really kind of fascinating dialogue between research expertise, practical expertise, and kind of policy development, and seeing that happen in different countries. You know, I think I just want to end by saying there's a management team trying to hold it all together, but really, you know, a huge amount of work is going on in all the countries that who are partners with us and each other, and the kind of emergent effects of the network are really very powerful and exciting. So I want to say thank you to everyone who's participated.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sonia. So then it just falls back to me to say thanks to all of you for joining today, for your great questions and for listening. Just to recap that we will share the slides from the presentation, and they'll also be embedded on the Global Kids Online website. The report itself, we're just going through the final stages of review and checking, and we hope by the time it gets to design layout and publication, we hope it will be out in the next couple of months, but we'll keep the distribution list and we will make sure that anybody who is interested is circulated a copy of it. So thanks again for listening, and I hope it was useful and valuable to you. Bye-bye.